Cheers, and welcome to the lonely intro from me for episode 81.5 of King Leo D&D. I am recording this as an intro to show a separate session that happened that Rachel and I met to do for what Tuli was able to accomplish on her own as she diverted from the party, went into the mausoleum after Tari Bod. And so we will transition there into an episode 81.5 where Rachel and I got to play off her little side quest. So go ahead and enjoy this wonderful, wonderful episode. Okay, so this sets us up right after the long rest that the party did in the other mausoleum, after Thelen had watched Lilith and Zolas leave the original mausoleum, and Tuli had woken up in the morning, and after Thelen had described who had left and that Tari was probably still in the mausoleum, Tuli got up to then head into that mausoleum to then find Tari. Gosh. This is going to be fun. So, after this long rest, to catch you up because you were missing, go ahead and roll your Threadweaver's Ring to get those reset for this.
Okay. Okay, one is a three.
Three and a 14, great. Okay, so, Tuli, you have left the mausoleum that you had slept in. It was a wonderful rest, by the way, because Thelen had created sprigs of lavender that grew up through the floor, and instead of smelling the stench of death within that space, you smelled pleasant lavender, and it was very helpful to sleep.
Some essential oils.
strategically placed around the room. And so, now, you have headed across the courtyard, in the midst of the morning, where you have seen two of the guards that were guarding this mausoleum that did reset over the night have headed inside to the citadel, and you have then ducked within the door of this mausoleum and are heading down the stairs, where you can faintly hear voices off in the distance in the room you originally confronted Lilith in.
Okay. I'm going to continue to creep my way down. Do I see anything of interest in this tunnel?
Sure, go ahead and roll a stealth check.
Okay. 16,
great. As you head down, also go ahead and roll a perception check for me.
Okay.
While you're walking down these stairs, you are passing crypts that line the walls on either side. Okay.
Dialed in. I'm laser focused, observing.
Yeah, absolutely. And so the voices grow a little bit clearer, but you cannot hear the words, but you can hear some distant, not necessarily whispers, but more hushed voices of two different figures off in the distance. But it is also very dark down here, and so you are into your shades of red and heat reading as you can. And you see along the walls down this hallway into that main room that you were in before, just different coffins and crypts that are stacked on one another about four or five high, and rows of them as you're heading down until eventually what becomes clear to you is the a little bit more than a half dozen of guards that were here with Lilith earlier are all almost perfectly in a line, dead on the ground, completely lifeless, unmoving.
In the main room?
In the main room, all the way down to the end. And so that becomes clear to you at this point. What would you like to do next?
I want to try and creep close enough that I can hear what they're saying and, like, crouch and listen for a second.
Yeah.
I'm also looking at the guards, trying to discern if any of them are breathing or alive.
Okay, great. Do one more stealth and perception check to then finish off the rest of this hallway and to grow closer to that room.
Okay. Stealth, 17.
Great.
And then perception, 10.
Okay, and for your sake, and for anyone's sake following along too, this is a completely separate instance from the rest of the campaign, since you have kind of split off on your own for this, and you had missed. So you will have Joffrey at your disposal at some point during this whole section as well. Joffrey, be good to her. So, he stares you down.
Joffrey belongs to everyone.
As you make your way to the end of the hallway, what first becomes a little bit clearer to you is that all of the...
Do I need to put the mic on?
No, you don't. We're just using that one. Yes, good call. Audio recording is not the way we're doing this right now. But anyway, so You get closer and you can see that a handful of them have bloodied wounds, and there are some of them that are sitting in pools of blood. Others of them are looking completely lifeless, as if without any wounds visible from this point, and their faces are like just kind of frozen and struck into this very ghastly, almost as if they died screaming, and their faces are frozen that way. And so you can see that array in front of you. And you can catch some of what's being spoken ahead, and a little bit. You can fully see the two figures in front of you, too. So off to the side of this chamber, towards the left, you see the sources of the two voices. They're huddled together, conversing with one another. One is a large druidic blood tree figure, similar to Romeo that you had seen in the lab.
Mr. B's little sidekick.
Yes. He has massive offshoots of branches intertwined with Duskglass, which is unique and separate from what Romeo looked like. He was not kind of built out with all of this Duskglass in it, but you can see that kind of woven and hanging from some of his branches and stuff that are hanging out as well, with massive offshoots of his branches and the Duskglass. The other, you do see your quarry, the one that you are after here in the space, Tari Bod, talking with that figure, which you can hear kind of broken in through this. You can hear her say, the matron of this former city. At one point, you can hear her say the word necklace, undead, and then also the word dragon.
I'm not like taking notes, but I don't know.
Yeah, no, you're good.
Undead, dragon, what was the other one?
Yes, spaces between those as well.
Okay. What was the first one?
It's a good question. She says, the matron of this former city.
Matron.
Necklace, undead, and dragon.
Okay.
What would you like to do next?
All right. Before I go in, I would like to cast first level mage armor.
Okay.
So I'm going to go ahead and cast that on myself.
Go ahead. So Tuli tucks into this corner, kind of where one of the coffin crypt things are kind of stowed away, right at the edge of entering into this room. You whisper the incantation to yourself, surrounding yourself with this magical aura before.
Yes.
And what do you do next?
All right. I'm going to continue to creep closer.
Mm-hmm.
I want to get as close enough to hear more of what they're saying.
Okay.
And I'm going to wait for my moment to enter.
Okay.
And confront her.
Got it. As you step forward, you can hear the voice clarify now that you're in a closer range of about 30 feet. And you hear her say, go, kill the undead, and take the object. They have already completed what we need. And then the tree-like figure, who is Tari's at, you can see her back, and this figure is facing her, kind of more facing into the direction of where you entered. He nods and then starts to step forward in your direction while you're entering the room.
Okay. I would wait for that character to leave.
Okay.
First, because I don't want to fight
mm-hmm.
both of them.
Yeah. He gets to a point maybe halfway through the room where he notices you and just stops in his tracks and kind of turns back towards Tari, and she, seeing him and then leaning over, then notices you.
I go...
she looks up towards this figure and goes, never mind her, she is nothing, go on and finish the job and we will prepare the gift
like your mom. No, I don't say that.
Yeah.
I kind of do I want to walk sideways, kind of like shaking out my arms, like,
yeah.
I have my wand in like a ready position,
mm-hmm.
but like low,
mm-hmm.
not threatening,
mm-hmm.
and I'm kind of or maybe it's like unholstered,
mm-hmm.
and I'm like ready to grab it.
Okay.
Basically,
yeah,
my hand's like hovering next to it, and I'm doing trying to as Tari moves, I don't know if she moves, but if she does, I'm like trying to match her,
and
around like a Mexican standoff, and I'm gonna say, so this is where you got off to.
The tree figure, just after her a comment, does just not even really look at you, just completely walks by and heads out of the space.
Tuli says, who's your friend?
And he heads back as you do just kind of this bit of a half circle of walking to kind of right yourselves in this space. He is She does respond.
Sorry.
You're good.
I thought you were texting me.
No. I'm so sorry. I'm making sure other people don't join us in here. He is an acquaintance of this realm and this land down here that is going to help us with the South Coves complete our goals and liberate both this land and those of our kin in Apori.
Oh, right. Okay. Your plan, your buku cuckoo plan to bring Apori under Drenton to the surface plane. That plan?
Yes, very much so. That one. The one that you are conspiring with Lilith to do as well.
Okay, I don't know. I don't know about all that.
What do you mean?
I mean, I was not aware that that was Lilith's plan. So conspiring is a strong word, Tari.
Well, then what have you ignorantly stumbled yourselves into then?
You know, I don't know. I'm hoping to find out soon, though. I mean, maybe you can tell me, like, what's going on here? You're trying to sell me on this idea of bringing Drenton up to, of joining Drenton to bring our people up. But so far, all I've heard is a lot of words. What's your plan? What's the tree guy here for?
He is the means by which we can create a gift for Drenton, something to increase his powers and likeliness to have victory over those that have crushed us and set us aside, deeming us unfit for this land up here.
So let me get this straight. You think that you can bribe, and she, Tari goes like this, mm-hmm. all this time she's like very carefully watching mm-hmm. Tari, Tuli does this, sorry.
Yes. Yeah,
she's
yeah.
carefully watching Tari for any signs from her martial art training, mm-hmm. like a shift in weight, anything mm-hmm. like that to indicate she's about to attack.
Sure.
So I'm ready.
For yeah.
And let me get this straight. So you are trying to bribe Drenton into not killing us when he raises Apori. Is that what you're doing? You really think that's going to work, Tari?
We would not die by the hands of Drenton. We would die by the hands of all of the vicious enemies that we have left in Apori, as well as by the hands of any from this land who would realize that they could come to Apori and take care of us themselves.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, look at me, super dead. I've been up here for like a year now. I've made great friends. They're some of my closest companions, and I wouldn't trade them for anything. They didn't kill me. They won't kill all of us. Some of them are awful, yeah, but some are great, like my companions.
Good for them. But you have been lucky enough, I suppose, not to meet those who devote their entire lives to serve the gods that would see you dead.
I'd rather us roll the dice, Tari, with people who might kill us and people who might be good friends to us than the side with Drenton, and 100%, he's gonna kill us. He doesn't give a crap about us. You know that. We've been in Apori together our whole lives. Listen to me.
He would wish to see those that he created stand at the top rather than be pressed down on the bottom.
If killing us in the crossfire means beating Valesa, he'll do it like that. And frankly, I don't see how it's possible for him to overthrow the plane that Valesa created without getting us caught in the crossfire.
You think he would discard those that achieved what he could not? That we would do this in his name and create the space that he had always wanted?
Yeah. Because I don't think he cares about us. I think Drenton cares about one thing. Drenton.
Well then, I will be one of those who stands directly under him, happily giving him the gift that I believe would preserve me and give me honor in his new kingdom.
Tari. And I'm going to try and convince her.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm going to say, Tari. And I'm going to even, like, even my weight out and kind of stand like this, hands.
Yeah.
Hopefully still monitoring her for a shift in weight,
sure.
But a little more vulnerable.
Yeah.
And say, Tari, we have a chance here to break the cycle that total B-word Valesa put us and our family in so many thousands of years ago. We don't have to do this. We don't have to kill each other on behalf of a god who doesn't give a crap about any of us, who's killed our children. You've seen the parades. This is our chance to break the cycle the right way. What you're doing is going to destroy us, not save us.
Go ahead and make a persuasion check.
My charisma's so low, I don't think I'm going to use Joffrey.
Well, you can roll first. Huh? You do get to roll first before Joffrey.
Persuasion. Six. So, what is... Can you... Joffrey is...
A plus five to whatever you roll. Like, your standard roll, exactly as you just did, you would roll that again, add whatever you would normally add to it, five.
Okay. I'm gonna use Joffrey.
Okay.
Why not?
Okay. You need to get a 19 total for this.
All right. Let's roll one more time. Actually, I'm gonna use a real die.
We'll
like
use the
real,
boulder.
Oh yeah, yeah. Okay. Like a real D&D player.
So Norse Foundry providing you with this wonderful opportunity to try to shift.
Thanks, Norse Foundry. Oh. Well, it's an 8.
Okay.
Thank you,
Joffrey. You served us well.
Thank you for
you made your best attempt.
Just kidding.
You see her stop kind of circling. She's standing firm at your attempt to clarify that Drenton would sooner stab her in the back than see her also live on the land of Candace. And she chuckles, kind of looks down, and then just firmly meets up at your eyes. What Drenton needs is the means necessary to wipe Valesa's precious, perfect little surface dwellers from Canvas to create space for those that he would see raised up in life and life flourishing up in Canvas. Those that were too good to live alongside us, rejects and discarded, crushed. So, at the Tripsis, Valesa will watch from her own entrapment beyond the stars as her creation is given over to the hell that she created.
Tuli's gonna kind of just look at her and like be a little sad for a second, and then she's gonna like take out her wand and say, she's gonna take out her wand and say, like, I literally have no idea what you're you have lost it, and I'm not going to let you do this. On behalf of Jigyasu, on behalf of the people that I love in Apori, I'm going to stop you. And I take out my wand and like do like a Obi-Wan Kenobi thing where he does like this.
Then you, and she raises her hand up, and between her like middle fingers, this like thick icicle javelin almost looking figure. Shall surely die confused. And then she lunges forward with this javelin, flying it towards you, about to impale you straight through the chest.
Okay, I am going to wait, like move forwards towards her, and...
I forgot to set that up earlier during the conversation, that's fine.
Okay, I am going to drop into a roll, and as I'm going to try and go under the icicle, and as I do that, cast like a swath of flame up at the icicle in her face.
Yeah.
And kind of like try and rise to my feet behind her with another firebolt prepped, like to aim at the back of her head is my goal.
Great. And so as the icicle javelin like melts between her fingers and you roll by behind her, the flames just shoot up by her face. You see like most of her form is then hidden from you behind the flames from your hands, and then eventually her face like pushes through as she comes down and she raises up her hands as tiny shards of ice crystals all form above her, and she drops them down and they're all flying straight down to try to cut down at you
as I'm rolling.
As you're rolling.
Okay, I am going to do a flip. Mm-hmm. Like a handstand flip backwards and try and dodge the icicles.
Mm-hmm.
And as I come up, I'm going to like come up from the handstand. I'm going to go like this and try to shoot out another, similar to Agonizer's Scorcher, like line of flame.
Right.
Torture.
Okay, so the crystals all smash down at the ground where you were, but you roll back behind them, and then from underneath of her feet, this geyser of flame completely engulfs her, and you see it just, like, raging up from floor to ceiling as she's standing within it, and then eventually it all just, like, immediately stops to a point where it's a black smoke and hissing as water is quickly evaporating from that space, where there's now a heavy rainfall around her, and she's used that to kind of cut out the flame that you were burning her with. She's breathing heavy, and part of her clothes are on fire. Her face is blackened and burned as she then kind of chuckles and looks towards you. You are a spark, Tuli, easily extinguished. A firefly flickering and fading, and I am an ocean, eternal and unstoppable. And then she moves her hands forward as a giant geyser of water then flies towards you in this thick jet.
Wow. Even like looks around like, what the hell? What are you, Shakespeare? What are you talking about? And like as the geyser of water comes at Tuli, she is going to try and dodge again.
Okay.
She's gonna roll.
Yep.
And as she comes up, she's gonna pull out her quarterstaff.
Mm-hmm.
And she's gonna like spin it, and she's gonna try and like throw, balls of fire off of the quarterstaff.
Okay, great.
So she's like using it like,
mm-hmm.
kind of thing.
Kind of like a baseball bat, just like
launching. Yeah, but like in a martial arts kind of
right.
Like,
yeah. And so the geyser, as you kind of move out of the way and she moves it and you're spinning your staff around, splits at your staff and you're using it to deflect the water jet. And then eventually as she stops casting that out, then you start launching the fireballs at her. She is like dancing and dashing between them at some points, almost evaporating into a misty smoke between them and using that to then move and break the distance between where she was and then where you are. And then at that, you both kind of lock together hand in hand and she starts creating this ball of watery ice between her hands right in front of your face, just getting ready to shower your face forward with a jet of water.
Tuli, like, spins her wand back to the front,
mm-hmm.
and you see, like, fire start to come down her hair.
Yeah.
Like, clearly amassing some amount of energy
and
fire. And she, like armbar, like, kind of, like, to get into a position where she can also be collecting that fire energy.
Yeah.
Like into the palm of her hand,
yes.
Like to create a blast
then
to deflect and hopefully overpower Tari's blast.
Okay, let's make contested Arcana checks.
Okay.
How fun!
This is fun.
She rolled a natural 20.
Oh no!
To be...
you're not going to believe this.
Did you roll... Get out.
Yeah, I rolled a 1.
Oh, I thought you also rolled a natural 20.
No.
I was like,
No.
Well,
that's not great.
Because I was gonna remind you could use your Threadweaver's ring.
But it's too late.
But it's one. You get a 1 reaction, so no matter which one you choose, if you choose her, you roll a natural 1. If you choose you, she still rolls a natural 20, right? You can't use both at the same time.
I can change her reaction to a 3. I still roll a 1.
You still rolled a natural 1. What would be an automatic failure for a skill check?
Yes, but a 20 decimates me, whereas a 3 maybe doesn't, right?
No.
No?
Not for this check.
This wasn't
like an attack roll. This isn't a
crit. The
20
doesn't matter. Okay.
Yeah.
That's fine. Then.
Yes. I want to make sure, that you're clear on what's happening with this dude. Okay, yeah. What is happening is in this lock of hands and these elements kind of joining together in this tension, you can see and she can sense it too as you both kind of look down to where your magical orbs of fire and water and ice are kind of coming together. You can sense that it's becoming very unstable and about to, you know, explode out. And as that's happening, you're both kind of fighting to shift the direction of that in a way that hurts the other and you get away. And so in the midst of that, she does win that bit of attention in that trade. And so she's going to move this explosive force of arcanic elemental magic off in your direction as she's launching backwards and you're launching backwards. So you're going to take just 2d6 bludgeoning damage as this explosive concussive force launches you back.
Is it too late to react?
You can still react, yeah.
That's what it called. I was going to think about adjusted stance.
Okay, got it.
But I think I'm just not going to react.
Okay, you're going to take 11 bludgeoning damage. There's 2d6, I rolled a 6 and a 5.
Whoa.
As this explosive force where the fire is quickly evaporating all of the ice and water and creating this almost vacuum space between the two of you, that you both fly back from the force. She lands in stable footing. You have been kind of knocked back and stumble backwards, taking a brunt of that force and feel winded, and you almost can't breathe as that concussive force hit you. Let's go ahead and roll initiative. We're going to do all of this in Theater of the Mind as well, so we're not going to set that stuff up.
Okay. 15.
Okay, she rolled a 17.
No!
So, with that, she is going to raise her hands back as you see that icy javelin appear within her hands, mm-hmm. and then she's going to just shift and throw that off in your direction. She rolled a... Where did I... What's that addition? She rolled a 14 to hit.
That does not hit.
Okay. So you dodge out of the way.
I roll.
Okay.
And kind of like shield my eyes against the icicle splinters.
Okay. You are up.
I'm up. Just kidding.
In the last episode when you weren't there, I described you getting ready to leave to go to the mausoleum, and I was like, Tuli cracks her knuckles, and then I cracked all my knuckles, and Sally was just like, Did you just prepare that? Did you? I was like, I don't know. It just felt like Tuli.
It was.
Yeah.
You channeled it. I love that. Okay. All right. I am in my wand. I have two spells. One of them is darkness. I cast it and used illusion.
Okay.
But I still have a darkness spell, and I still have, or I absorbed a dominate person spell.
Yes.
So I'm going to cast Magic Missile.
Okay.
No, actually, I'm going to use my wand to cast Chromatic Orb.
Okay.
And she has to dodge that, I think.
Okay.
And I'm going to do it at highest level.
Okay.
And I'm going to use my Thread Reaver's Ring to give her, to make her fail it. If she doesn't.
Let me roll first.
That's what I'm saying. I'm telling you now.
Okay. Burn the ring. You see the reality where she dodges out of the way, just immediately responds back with this anger on her face, and you're able to then summon the power of the Thread Weaver and get Anivia to assist you on this. So
okay.
you can burn that three.
I don't know, you tell me if anything happens. Mm-hmm. I would be trying to focus on the energy of dominate person.
That,
I don't know.
That only works with the magic missile stuff.
Oh, does it?
Yes.
Oh. Okay, I still miss one.
Okay.
Okay, I'm sorry. It's been a while since I played, so I'm trying to remember where
no, you're
my
good.
Spells are.
You're good.
Alright, I cast at her Chromatic Orb
mm-hmm.
at the highest level,
mm-hmm. which is level,
and I'm gonna use poison.
Okay, what level are you casting that at?
At fourth.
Okay, she's using her reaction to try to counterspell you.
Okay,
so she's doing that at the third level, so she does have to roll. So if you're doing that at fourth level,
mm-hmm.
DC is 10 plus the spell's level, so she needs to roll a 14. To counterspell your Chromatic Orb. Troll 11.
Yes!
So you see her try to counterspell it as you... dang, this is really dope. Okay, so you're spinning this crystal within your hand, forcing arcane energy into it. Then you then see as it makes contact with the crystal, shifts into this green poison spray that then flies over towards her. You see the reality where she steps out of the way and gets away from it. But then you... summon the power of Anivia to then kind of twist that reality into one where she has failed. And in that moment, too, her hands just twist in front of you as she then begins to counterspell it. And you are familiar with that spell, but there's nothing you can do to prevent that because you've already used all of your energy for the spell and to beckon the Thread Weaver's Ring in your side. And so as then she creates this magical arcane wall in her hands that she then goes to try to absorb your spell with. Your poison spray just overtakes it, and she absorbs some of it, but then after that, her hands just kind of explode as her counterspell is not strong enough, and then she's fully taking the blast of your poison spray there from your chromatic orb. So go ahead and roll your full damage.
Okay, when you cast the spell using spell slot of second level or higher, the damage is increased by 1d8 for each spell slot above first. Okay, so above first, second, third, fourth, so plus 3d8. Wait, what is the damage?
While you're looking that up,
It's 3d8, so it's 68.
Yes, okay. Perfect. And you can see in the midst of this, too, that Tari's not fully rested, that she has been still nursing some of the wounds from the fight that she had with the rest of your party over when she was with Farlane. Go ahead with your damage.
29.
29 damage, okay.
Yeah, and I'm going to use... Oh, wait. Is it too late to use... some of my redirected energy with it. Once per turn when you deal with a martial attack.
Yes, you can, yeah. Okay, cool. 29 damage, okay. With that, you can see from the energy that she has left, the whatever that she has to be in this fight with you right now, that she's in a very rough space, that she already was not in a very a great position of strength to begin this, that she's been nursing some wounds and fighting for her best to be... even in the mausoleum, doing everything that she has been. And so with a hit like that, you can see that that's a significant hit towards what she has left within her. Yeah.
So I know from previous investigation that she has 200 hit points. Mm-hmm. I learned that especially.
Yes.
To have a perception of where she might fall on that scale. Like
you can add an insight check right now.
Okay. 8.
Okay. I will say she has started, when you're meeting her now, she was somewhere around or less than half. She's somewhere less than half than that to begin with.
Okay.
Okay. That is it for your turn then.
Yes.
As you are still about 30 feet apart, she then is... okay, got it. She looks down, sees that some of her skin is kind of burning away. Launches her eyes back up at you. I'm more powerful than you. You're the betrayer. You will be brought to shame. I will make you pay for what you've done. I'm going to make you regret ever crossing me. Make a wisdom saving throw. As she then is going to... You hear that her voice echo into your head. This is it. I will take you out. You will be mine. And you hear these whispers bouncing around.
Nervous. Okay.
You know that she's casting Dominate Person as well at this moment.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
17.
It passes.
Yes!
So, as she is filling your mind with these commands to throw yourself down on the ground and to kind of just give yourself over so that she can kill you. All of these voices are flooding into your mind, and you do get this flashback to a time in Apori, your last day in Apori, where you were sparring publicly for this school versus school, family versus family challenge that was happening, where you were trying to, show the honor of the Jugyasu school and show that your training was superior to others. And you remember this time that, that Tari, even though you were not fighting her, she used some mind controlling and altering spells to kind of get on your nerves within the fight, but then also distract you, and what led you to ultimately... accidentally kill this colleague, this child from an enemy school that you were also fighting, and caused you to then flee and lead you into this world of Canvas. And as she's trying to fight for that once more, even here, all of this history and relation between you and her is just flooding your mind and burning your anger towards her. You're up.
As I'm struggling with that blast, I would say that, like, what kind of, like, peeks through it in a moment of clarity is the voice of Jigasu and my parents.
Yeah.
And with that, I'm able to, like, collect myself after beating this. And I kind of, like, have my hands on my knees because I'm remembering it's reminiscent of the mind link spell that causes me to... is triggering. And I kind of use those happy memories to collect myself, stand back up, and I am going to use Magic Missile. My intention is to focus on the dominate person elements within. I don't know exactly how that works, but that is my intention. And I'm only going to use one of the charges, because that's all I have.
Okay.
Actually, I have two charges, and if I use them, I have to roll.
Yes.
And if I get a one, my wand is destroyed.
Yes.
Is it worth it? Is it worth it, Dan? I'm praying to Dan. Is it worth it?
Yeah.
All right, I'm just going to use one.
Okay, so roll your d4.
So I'm casting it at... Does that mean first level? That's not how this works. Sorry.
The magic missile, right?
Yes. For one charge, you cast a first level version of the spell. Which is, at first level, 1d4 plus 1.
Okay,
and
go ahead.
I'm aiming for the burned section of her arm.
Okay, go ahead and roll the d4.
With the forearm or whatever it is. 1d4 plus 1, right? 3.
Okay, got it. So she's going to take 3 damage. And then what you also see is, as this magic missile... leaves the wand, that there's elements and motes of this purplish green and yellow sparkles that are going up as well, and you know that you have harnessed this energy of the dominate person from dispelling that earlier.
Can I say, as I cast it, I yell out, "Don't make me do this, Tari."
Great. As that hits her, and she takes that damage, you can see that all of these sparkles then flutter up towards her face and her mind, and as they spiral around, you can see them absorb magic kind of like out of her. Make an arcana check.
Whoa.
Okay. As you're reading what's happening in this... space before you. You've never seen magic behave in this way, but it's almost as if these sparkles and whatnot are getting into her, and then you can see the arcana that's leaving her, and it's this aura of dominate person-ness. This, what is the essential nature of the arcane that is the dominate person spell? All of it is just like evaporating off of her and being absorbed by those sparkles. With a 16-2, she cannot cast the dominate person spell anymore.
Yes!
Yes, okay. And after that, also, in your mind, as you are, this wave of relief is washing over you even, and as you recount your family and Dugyasu, your trainer, as well, you can hear his voice in your mind, and he just says, "Anger fuels victory." And you just hear his voice speaking to you. One of the tenets of the martial training that you've heard him for in the past. That's it for your turn?
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So, Tari, then. No. What is happening? What are you even doing? What training is this? And then she is going to shadow step, and so she's going to dissipate into vapor and then launch up right up next to you. She's going to rip from its holt, its hilt, its scabbard, that's what I'm trying to say, that very jagged dagger that she was using, and as you remember that, this is what she was using against Lilith in that first assassination attempt on your first night in Duskforge, and so this dagger is then brandished, and
do I have to react before you roll?
No.
Okay.
Would you like to react?
Oh, wait, I don't know what it is.
You know, no.
Okay.
Yeah. So, thank you for that moment to roll the die.
Sure, you're welcome.
Yeah.
Okay, Adjusted Sense says when you are hit by an attack or you fail a saving throw.
Yes.
So I do get to know that.
Yes.
Right?
Does a 14 hit you?
Does not.
Oh, then you are not hit by the attack?
Cool.
Great. And so this jagged dagger comes forward.
I don't care, I'm fine, this is fine.
You can tell that when she appears right in front of you that she's still shaken and she's very much mentally off kilter from this going absolutely not the way that she had anticipated, and you using the Threadweaver's ring and then her counterspell not working, and then you dodging these attacks and everything. She's just now like, what you can see is her anger and frustration leads to flustering, and your anger and frustration leads to success and becoming in tune with it. And so she is just becoming like completely I don't know the word I'm looking for right now, like untethered by her anger, where she's completely like falling apart and not being able to really restrain and keep herself within her training as she should.
Can I give you some color?
Yeah.
As I remember that tenet mm-hmm. of anger fuels victory,
yeah.
I remember a focus technique mm-hmm. that I learned in the school of Jigyasu, mm-hmm. which is you picture your anger as a raging fire mm-hmm. out of control, causing you to be sloppy, mm-hmm. and then you visualize tightening it mm-hmm. down into a single flame.
Yeah,
and it's almost like a void within you that yeah. helps you focus mm-hmm. your anger and make it pure.
Yeah,
and so I'm doing that technique.
Yeah,
and so in my mind, I'm just seeing the little flame, which also is yeah. my name.
yes,
ironically, I'm living up to my name.
Yes.
It is your turn. Tuli Palo means, or Tuli means little fire.
Yes. It is your turn.
Okay. All right. So using that concentration that I've developed, so she came, she's close to me. She like tried to stab me. She missed. Did I like block it?
Yes.
Or, okay. Yep. So maybe I'm like blocking her yeah. right now. All right. I can't use any of my long-range spells at this distance, right?
I'd have
to disengage.
If it's an attack roll, it would be at disadvantage. But if it's a saving throw, you're fine.
Okay. I am going to catch the diamond in my hand, and I'm going to cast Chromatic Orb
mm-hmm.
one more time.
Okay, what level?
That's a great, great question.
I've learned to start asking you that.
You
at
should.
This point.
I will not remember. At fourth level.
Okay.
Can I say that I'm like when she grabs me, mm-hmm. or like when she like
yeah.
comes at me, and I try to grab her hand
mm-hmm.
and like hold her so that I can
yes.
cast it.
Yep.
And I'm aiming it like at an angle straight into her face,
yeah.
basically.
Go for it.
No, actually, I'm aiming it at her chest.
Okay. And this is a dexterity saving throw?
This is a...
Chromatic Orb, right?
I think it's just the spell modifier or whatever.
It's a spell attack?
It's like the save DC.
It needs to be tied to a particular stat.
I don't think so. I think it's just the save.
If the attack hits. No, you do a spell attack. This would be one that would be at disadvantage.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
All right. Can I rewind?
Sure.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah, you make a ranged spell attack. That is one of the ones that you would be...
Well, no, I don't roll for it. She just has, you said if it's a saving throw, right? I thought that meant like if she just has to dodge that. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yes. No, the Chromatic Orb is a spell attack.
Because I've always done it as it's a saving throw. Like they, with beating
so,
that.
So it shouldn't be. So if it was, like you see this spell, I can have a sword your dex 15. So that's a saving throw.
Okay.
This one has nothing. It is a spell attack. For some reason it doesn't populate for you, but if the attack hits, it's a ranged spell attack.
Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah, we should make that adjustment if I've missed that.
Yeah,
in the past.
Sorry.
You're fine.
Okay, in that case, I'm going to rewind.
Yep.
And I am going to just like glance, like try
mm-hmm.
and like block her hard so
mm-hmm.
that she's, I want her to like swing wide open.
Yeah.
And I am going to spin my quarterstaff, and I'm going to try. I'm going to cast Flurry of Blows.
Okay.
And I'm going to. So I'm going to take the attack action, and then I'm going to make two more bonus attacks, and I'm going to add my force direction.
Yes, you are.
To it.
Right.
And that applies to all four?
Yes.
All, I mean, all three?
Yes.
Okay. So I'm going to roll three times. I burn that spell slot. And then I roll Flurry of Blows.
Let's go ahead and just make the three attack rolls.
Which is a d20. It's been a long time.
Yes. And so while you're rolling those, this is a feature of your School of the Applied Mind. So it's a homebrewed class. So if this sounds weird to you as D&D rules, it's because this is a particular hybrid blend of a wizard and a monk that I made for her. So.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so on one of them, I think only one is going to hit.
Okay.
I rolled a 13, a 3, and an 18.
Okay.
I don't add anything to that, do I?
It would be your standard quarterstaff attacks. So it should, you should.
Oh, wait. I do add to that.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
You're fine. Where is your.
Okay. 13, unarmed strike, so plus 4. So 17, 7, and 22.
Okay, two of those hit.
Nice.
So make roll the damage for your quarterstaff.
For two.
For two hits for your quarterstaff, yeah.
And then add 8. Because the force,
yes.
Redirected energy, once per turn. Martial attack, you spend one power surge, and I have one because of my long rest, to deal an extra 4 plus damage.
Yes.
Okay. So, roll the damage. So, 5. Oh my gosh. 10 plus 8,
18. 18 total?
Yeah.
Okay. So.
I rolled 1 twice on the
d6. Gosh, yeah. So, as you are redirecting her attack, you get out of the way of that, and then you spin the quarterstaff up. You apply your arcane energy to give you a little extra boost in movement to get a couple more attacks in with your quarterstaff. And you do 3 quick swings with it, empowering them even with harnessed arcane magic that you have absorbed in earlier fights. And then so you push that forward, and 2 very strong concussive blows hit her on both sides of her ribs as you smack those both in.
Can I give you the... I would try to make the last blow like a gut check, and I wanted to get some distance enough to do a ranged attack, is what I wanted.
Okay. There's a particular shove attack thing that is a feature to do that. But we're getting thematic, and this is, you know, a very high energy thing. So what I will do is have us do contested arcana checks for that as well.
Okay.
Gotta beat a 15.
22.
Well then, okay, great. So as you do that, that extra force that you've thrown in from this ability and this skill, then pushes her back, and so now she's 10 to 15 feet away from that, but it's also her turn. Okay. So then, with that, newfound space, do me a favor. Roll, like, a d6.
Okay.
If it's even, she's gonna come forward for the melee attack. If it's odd, she will stay distant for an arcane attack.
Odd.
So she'll stay distant. I didn't want to make that decision because I knew that you wanted to keep the distance, so I wanted to keep that unbiased. So at that distance then, she's going to twist her hands together, create another icicle, and then try to launch that off.
Okay, I'm
going to
react with counterspell.
Okay.
And I'm going to cast that at, I think I can only cast it at 4th level. No, I can't. I can cast it at 4 levels. No, wait. Do I want counterspell or dispel magic? Because she already...
It would be counterspell. Dispel magic is more like out of combat.
I erupt a creature, if she is casting a spell 3rd level or lower, the spell fails and takes no 4th level or higher, make an ability check. So what's the difference? Why does it matter? Like, what's the advantage to casting it at 3rd versus 4th level?
That depends on what the level of the spell she is casting is.
Okay. I'm going to cast it at 3rd level.
Okay. And then I need you to roll d20 for me.
Okay. Oh, my God.
Got to beat a 13. Or 14, I'm sorry.
It's 7.
Okay. As this javelin is created, you pull it up.
Can I use my third bruiser ring, or I already reacted with counterspell?
Counterspell is a reaction. Okay. Yeah. She then creates this ice javelin that is then going to fly forward towards you. This one finally making contact and hitting you. I think this is the first attack you actually landed against you, except for the big explosion. It's going to be 11 cold damage.
Okay.
That's it for her turn. Oh, she's going to say something as well. Let me pull this up real quick. As you launched her back.
She says, all the world's a stage.
She just threw gritted teeth, heavy breath, just throws that javelin towards you. She sees it kind of strike into your arm. And now there's this like open spot where you're bleeding out of your shoulder. You're a sellout, Tuli. You're a traitor and a disgrace.
As a free action,
tell me if I can do this. Yeah, you can respond.
It's not. Let me tell you what it is, and you can tell me this free action.
Great.
I want to flip her off.
Yep.
And I don't know if this would be casting, but I want to just have heat on the end of my finger and go like this and cauterize the
wound. Sure, that's totally fine.
Okay, yeah. So I do that, and then I cauterize the wound. And my teeth are also gritted. I'm picturing hair, stringy everywhere, middle combat.
Yeah. You were up.
Coming out, I think it's in a braid, maybe.
Okay.
And it's falling out of the braid.
Right.
Okay. All right. Now, at this distance, I am going to cast Chromatic Orb.
Okay.
Which, how should I do that?
So roll a d20, and then you add your spell attack bonus, which is right at the top of all of your spells.
Okay. And I can react with Threadweaver's Ring for this.
Yep.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I might do that.
What level are you casting this on?
4th. It didn't roll. It didn't stop.
You're good.
Oh my gosh. Okay. 18 plus 8.
Got it.
Yeah, I see.
26. Yeah.
All right. This time, I am going to use... I don't remember if she has a vulnerability or any kind of... Maybe you can... If I've learned that, maybe you can remind me. But I want to use Thunder.
Okay.
In the, or like,
Yeah.
Because I'm picturing, lightning. No one used lightning, actually. Because I'm picturing, lightning passing through water.
Yeah.
And, zapping her.
Got it. Right. You know that water genasi are resistant to acid damage, so your poison and your thunder damage are totally fine.
Nice. Okay.
Roll that damage.
All right. That's my last 4th level. Okay, so that would be 6d...
6?
D8.
6d8, okay.
Yeah.
23. Okay, she's on her last leg. Very low, but that was not quite enough. You can see as this thunder damage has struck her, and this more of a shock wave that hits her, drives her to her knees as she's now gasping for air, and as she comes up, you can see...
This is lightning damage, by the way.
Thunder is the actual damage type.
Because it says thunder or lightning.
I got you. Yes.
I really want to hit her with a lightning
bolt. Yeah. Okay, great. Cool. Yes.
It doesn't matter.
You're totally right. No, and that's cool imagery as well. Yeah. And you see the static shock kind of fly through the diamond and over towards her. And as that does, you can see it rippling throughout her body and her. Normally, just like you, even though you are fused with the element of fire, you have skin and flesh. That does share in elements and balance between you and fire, just like that with her is with that and water. And you can see her almost shift back and forth between her regular humanoid form and this fluid form. And she's kind of tripping between both of them as the electricity radiates through her body. And you can see when she's in the watery form that it's just completely shocking all the way through. And in that imbalance with her, in her, she's driven down to the ground before pushing herself back up. I've played with you long enough. And then now she's going to dive forward and try to lunge towards you with her dagger one more time.
Okay.
Okay. It's a 22 to hit.
Yeah, that hits.
Okay.
Yeah.
17 piercing damage. as this dagger is now pierced straight into your kind of gut and off into the side, and you can feel it like pressing in between two ribs as she goes to try to twist it and kind of and then rips it back out as one of your ribs. You can feel it just kind of pops, and she may have broken one of them from stabbing you into the side.
Okay, all right, so she's in close now.
Yes.
All right, I'm gonna try and take her down with unarmed strikes.
Okay. Again. You can do one before you decide if you want to do Flurry of Blows.
Okay, I'm going to do that. And I'm going to, like, I'm going to, like, say one last thing and kind of, like, beg her almost and say, like, as I'm stumbling and, like, gathering the thing, I'm like, wait, like, I don't really want to give her an opening, but I would say, Tari, I'm begging you, please don't do this. This is who Valesa made us to be. This isn't who we are.
You will always be in my way.
Okay, so I go in for it. Congratulations, you maybe played yourself. We'll see. Okay, I'm going to use one unarmed strike.
Mm-hmm.
And to hit.
Well, you mean with your quarter staff, right?
Yeah.
That's just a quarter staff attack, not unarmed.
Oh. 22.
That hits.
Roll damage. 4.
She had 3 hit points. So, you may describe your killing blow on Tari Bob.
Okay. She had just stabbed me, and I like pull my quarterstaff, and to get momentum, like holding my side, I do like a spin. And bring it, like, cracking down on the side of her head.
Yeah.
Like, really hard, such that it, like, sends her to the ground.
Yeah.
And then, like, I, from the momentum, like, fall to my knees and, like, drop my staff. And I'm just kind of, like, staring there, looking at her, seeing what she does.
In that split moment, as you were readying the strike and coming forward after your spin, she had pulled her dagger up and was lunging straight for your throat. As you read the moment, as everything had slowed down, you knew right there that this was going to be a lethal blow on you, that she was going in for the kill, and you were able to then pull the quarterstaff up and just touch it over to the side as you twist it around and then crack her into the side of the head. And as you do that, you know that that has completely shut off any connection between her mind and her body, and she then kind of twists off from the blow, falls down onto the ground, and is completely still.
As I'm sitting there on the ground, kind of like on my hands and knees, like panting a little bit, like looking at her, I don't feel triumphant. Mm-hmm. I feel the flame kind of dissipates that I've been envisioning and kind of peters out into like some sparks. And now all I feel is grief. And I, not really for Tari necessarily, but I kind of like sit back on my heels and look at my hands, and all I can think is, Willis has won again. And, yeah.
With that, you can take some time within the space in this room. You know that your party has pushed on towards Lilith and apparently her grandfather's Olas as well, and they are probably in the midst of some danger, but you have taken care of a loose end and a rampant issue in this area of the world.
I mean, let's be real. I'm going to go through her pockets. I'm not that sad.
Great. Cool. And we will cover that in the interim. But you may now. We'll end this here, and then we'll rejoin you with the party eventually.
That was fun.
That was really great.
That was good.
Oh, my gosh. I enjoyed that so much.